Good morning, everybody, and welcome here. It's good to see you. Before we continue, I want to share some exciting news with you. This coming week, again on Thursday evening, we gather together in Hopefield to pray. Thank you, Aldrich. So Aldrich and myself will be there. You're welcome to join us, to be with us. 20 past 6, we're going to leave from Beacon's parking lot. So you can either squeeze in with a car or drive with us. We will meet together in the community hall in Hopefield, and we're going to pray from 7 o'clock in the evening till 8 o'clock. We're praying, we're trusting God to lead and guide us. We're trusting God that together with all the other local churches, we'll be able to plant a local church there, multicultural, multi-generational church. And we believe God has called us in this season. Part of our network and family of churches around the world is to plant and strengthen churches. And we trust in God to plant a vibrant New Testament church of all nations and cultures and generations within the town of Hopefield. So come and pray with us. If you cannot join us, please, you've been invited this morning to pray. And may you also set apart this time at your home, Thursday evening, 7 till 8 o'clock. We've been singing, "We Bow Down Before You." And so this morning in our singing, we've been worshiping God and maybe bowing down before Him in the posture of our hearts, maybe physically bowing down, lifting up our hands, being drawn into the truth of who Jesus is and what He has done, and singing about that. And singing is such an important part of human life and of our emotions. It's part of how we're declaring praise to God. And on the one hand, we're singing, "We bow down before you." But this morning, I trust that our text, that God will speak from His text, and Holy Spirit arranged this text to be in this particular manner there. And it will not only speak to the church in Corinth in the first century, but to you and me. And we will look at our hearts. How do we bow down our hearts? It's easy to sing, "I bow down before you." But how do we actually live? How do we actually bow down our hearts before Him? Now, I wonder, have you ever crossed or ever came across the following picture where it says, you cannot drive further, you cannot walk, you do not enter, the road is closed, no access. And you are thinking, the road cannot be that bad, can it? I can surely drive, I can surely go on. And the further and further you drive on this road, you actually realize that it is actually pretty bad. I should actually listen and heed to the warning signs. It is that bad. Some time ago, my wife and I went to Strandfontein, and we took a little dirt road, and I thought, this road can't be that bad. It's a gravel road. I cannot really drive there with my car, but it can't be that bad. And a couple of kilometers in this road, I figured out that I cannot drive any further. There's lots of loose sand. I'm going to get stuck. And for 10 kilometers, I had to reverse because there was no turnaround. You see, friends, we should not ignore the danger signs. And so from the first century, the church, up until the 21st century, probably one of the greatest dangers to the church is not from outside the church, but from within the church. Paul warned the elders in Ephesus. In Acts 20, he was embracing the elders. They were greeting one another. Probably this was the last time that Paul is going to see them. And then Paul crying and Paul saying, I know that when I leave, wolves will come in. Savages will come in. Wolves dressed in sheep's clothing. And they will cause havoc amongst the church. And it's no different in the 21st century. We're dealing with challenges like absolute truth. How can you really trust God's word? You see, it's not just outside of the church, but it's also within the church. Do we really hold God's word as the absolute truth? You know, maybe God's got an opinion about marriage, but He cannot have the final say. I mean, after all, it's my life. After all, I can decide to be happy or not. So you want to tell me that God doesn't want me happy? fact, God wants you holy. And if you're going to make a decision between your happiness and your holiness, He wants you holy. God's got the absolute final authority in life. And that means God has the final authority in terms of how we define marriage, amongst other things. Or we might just want to preach a gospel of love and grace. God is a God of love. God's a God of grace. And so we fall into hyper-grace. And God will always forgive, and you can just carry on. And we forget that God is a holy God. We're just singing, holy, holy. It's easy to sing this. And it's easy to be sucked into emotionalism when we sing this. But brothers and sisters, what happens tomorrow morning? And the day after and the day after? Do we preach living a continuous life of repentance? Not unto salvation, but unto growing in holiness. Do we only focus on the love and the mercy of God, but we forget that He's a holy God as well? That God is a God of righteous judgment. Do we understand this? Do we preach an easy gospel? Do we preach a self-help gospel? You know, God wants you happy. God wants you wealthy and health and wealth and all the good things God wants for you now. God wants you to live your best life right here on this earth. Is that what the Bible teaches? Do we teach a self-help gospel where Jesus becomes a stepping stone to live your best life now? Or is there something else? Do we seeking all kinds of revelations? People walking into the pulpit and I have this revelation from God. And they preach a sermon, but it's not what the Word is saying. I just had this revelation. God spoke to me about this. Do we look for the popular preachers? I saw the other day, a specific person has got over 1 million followers on TikTok and Instagram. In today's society, that is what marks someone as a Bible preacher. The more followers you have. Really? If the sermon that you're listening to and the sermon that you're hearing, if the points are not coming from the Word of God and you cannot connect it from the Word of God, it becomes motivational speaking. It becomes motivational preaching, and we're falling into what Paul says to Timothy. In the last days, between the ascension and the second coming of Jesus, people will gather teachers for them by the way that they follow to hear what their itchy ears want them to hear. They want to be soothed. They want to be encouraged. I want to feel good about myself because it's all about me, myself, and I. I want Jesus to be a stepping stone to a happy life on this earth. Is that what we're following? Is that what we want to hear? You see, those are dangerous things that comes into the church. Church leaders can lead churches astray. By preaching not the truth of the gospel, but a self-help gospel, a me-centered gospel. Therefore, as churches, we need to pray for our leaders. We need to pray for the eldership team. We need to pray that when we preach, we're in fact not here to impress people. I cannot impress you with good public speaking and encouraging you and use all kinds of good examples and humor and whatever, other than coming from the Word of God. And let the Word of God speak. God's Word is powerful. God's Word and God's Spirit is what's supposed to penetrate the hearts and minds of people. And so when we open up the Word of God, this is a holy moment. This is a powerful, sacred moment when we read publicly from the Word of God. When we have the opportunity to expound what God's Word is saying to us, and not what you want to hear, but what He is saying. So let's be careful how church leaders can lead churches astray. And no one is exempt from that. No preacher is exempt from that. And I pray that especially those who preach the Word of God, who will be judged harder than others, that God will help us by His grace, we will grow and make progress in handling the Word of God correctly. Because that's also what Paul instructs Timothy. Make sure that we handle the Word of God correctly. And that is our prayer, and may God help us. And by no ways do I stand in a place of boasting that we are getting it right every time. But I pray that God will look at our hearts and the motives of our hearts, that we will do this. And I want to encourage you and ask you, who do you listen to? Who do you read? When you get onto social media and YouTube, who are the preachers that you are listening to? Because it matters. Brothers and sisters, it matters. Don't follow popular people. Follow the preachers of the Word of God. There are many, 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 many sound teachers of the Word of God. Many around there. And there are many other that preach what people want to hear. Be careful what you hear and what you read. So let's get into our text this morning. We're preaching through the book of 2 Corinthians. And we're in chapter 6 this morning, reading from verse 14 to chapter 7, verse 1. And that text part this morning is a together dealing with the temple of the living God. So our text this morning is addressing the issue of the holiness of God. It's addressing the issue that you and I are the temple of God. It is looking at idolatry. It's looking at idols in our own hearts. This morning, what is Holy Spirit saying to you, to us as a local church? So hear the word of God this morning. I'm reading from the English Standard Version. Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? What accord has Christ with Belial? Or what portion does a believer share with an unbeliever? What agreement has the temple of God with idols? For we are the temple of the living God, as God said, I will make my dwelling among them and walk among them. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, go out from their midst and be separate from them, says the Lord, and touch no unclean thing. Then I will welcome you, and I will be a father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty. Since we have these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from every defilement of body and spirit, bringing holiness to completion in the fear of God. You see, here we have reference to living out our holiness. I've been justified. I'm declared righteous in Jesus Christ. We've seen that in chapter 5. Now I'm declared righteous. Christ's holiness, Christ in me, that is my holiness. But I need to live out this holiness. I don't live for salvation. I live from salvation, from my identity, from my position, from my declaring of righteous standing in Jesus. Now from that position, I bring my holiness completion in the fear of God. So my growing in holiness is not so that I can be holier than thou. It is in the fear of God. It is standing before a holy God. It is easy to sing about a holy God. It's another thing to live in the fear of a holy God. Out of reverence for Him. Not because He's going to judge me. Not to try and please Him to win my salvation. I can never win my salvation. Jesus has done it for me. So it's from that position that I live. So now the question is, what is Paul addressing here? Is Paul speaking and helping you and me? Is this text in front of us when Paul says, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers? Is that the fridge magnet text that I go to? Is this the kind of rule book that I go to in how I choose my business partners or how I choose the person that I marry? Which one is it? Or is it neither? Well, let's see. If we delve into the historical context of this letter and understanding why is Paul writing, we come to understand that Paul is writing to this church that he planted, and there's some false apostles. Paul called them the super apostles. These people that came in, and they were actually accusing Paul and saying, Paul cannot speak as good. Paul is not as eloquent as we are. And Paul is not as well-dressed as we are. And Paul is not the full package. And he's always been persecuted. And he's always struggling. And he's always sick. And he has to work for money. And you know what? He cannot be a true apostle. And then sarcastically, Paul calls these guys the super apostles. And they come in with a teaching. And they preach a different gospel and a different Jesus. And these guys in the church in Corinth, the historical background is they've been pulled away and they're following Jesus. They're standing in God's kingdom with the one foot and the other foot, they're walking into idol temples and they worship idols. They partake in idol worship. It's not that they eat the meat that has been sacrificed to idols. Don't misunderstand. There's nothing wrong with the meat. It is what accompanies the meat. When they enter into temples of idols. It's like when you finish now with this meeting, you go over to the mosque and you go and pray in the mosque just to cover all your bases. It's kind of the same thing. Just for in case you might be wrong. So in the historical context, we see something different is happening. And if we just read the verses around our text this morning to help us to understand, when Paul says, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers, what is he saying this morning? Well, in chapter 11, verse 5, he referenced these guys that were in the church, and he called them these super apostles. They're taking the church away from the gospel, and Paul deeply cares for the church in Corinth. He planted this church. This church is in his heart, but the church has closed their hearts for him. So let's read chapter 6, and let's just read from verse 11 to verse 13. We have spoken freely to you, Corinthians. Our heart is wide open. You are not restricted by us, but you are restricted in your own affections. Paul says, you don't love us anymore. In return, widen your hearts for us. But it was not just the false apostles that came in with preaching a different gospel. The Judaism also infiltrated the church. They were following Jesus plus something else. They were saying the same thing that happened in the church in Galatia. You know, you are saved by the finished work of Jesus Christ. But if you really want to be saved and remain saved, you need to get circumcised. So it's all about the external stuff. The clothes that we wear. Oh, we're going to church. You know, we're going to the temple. This is not the holy place. This is not the altar. We're singing that song. This is not the church. This is a building, bricks, mortar. This is the church. This is not the temple. This place we gathered is not the temple. We are grateful that God has given us this building. You and I, we are the temple, individually and collectively. We are the temple. And then in chapter 7, verse 1, verse 2, make room in your hearts for us. We have wronged no one. We have corrupted no one. We have taken advantage of no one. I do not say this to condemn you, for I said before that you are in our hearts to die together and to live together with us. I'm acting with great boldness towards you. I have great pride in you. I'm filled with comfort in all our affliction. I'm overflowing with joy. He's asking this church to receive him, to open up their hearts for him. But then we read even further than these chapters, and we find ourselves in chapter 11. And we're reading in this book to understand what Paul is saying in 2 Corinthians 6, verse 14. What does it mean not to be yoked with unbelievers? If we find ourselves in chapter 11, the first 6 verses, he says the following. I wish you would bear with me a little foolishness. He's been sarcastic now. Do bear with me, for I feel a divine jealousy for you since I betrothed you to one husband. He committed them to Jesus Christ. He says, church, you are married to Jesus. I betrothed you to one husband. Listen to this. To present you a pure virgin to Christ. What does it mean? He says, I'm going to present you to Jesus Christ. He says to the church in Colossae, he said, I work with all God's power and energy in me to present you mature, a virgin. A virgin means it is a woman and a man that has not had sexual intercourse with anyone else, but coming into the safe covenant environment of marriage, there they have unity in sexual intercourse. And God speaks throughout the Bible and says, when his people follow after false gods, what is it called? Adultery. So what is happening in this church? There's adultery. There's spiritual adultery. They're following and worshiping false gods. They're entering the temples of other gods of the nations around them. It says, I betroth you to be a pure virgin to Christ. But I'm afraid that as the serpent deceived Eve by his cunning, your thoughts will be led astray from a sincere and a pure devotion to Jesus. For if someone comes and proclaims another Jesus than the one we proclaim, like, just pass, okay, mostly on Saturdays, you'll see people dressed up, you see them, dressed in nice clothing to try and impress God by their clothing. Yeah, there's nothing wrong to be dressed smartly. There's nothing wrong to have your suit or to wear your baggies and your slops. There's nothing wrong with it. But I know these people are religious. Their religiosity informs their dress code, and they stand there and they hand out things, and they're called the Jehovah's Witnesses. They proclaim another Jesus. They do not proclaim that Jesus is God himself, but that he was born in the flesh there, that Jesus was created by God. They do not believe that Jesus rose bodily from the grave, but spiritually. No, Jesus rose bodily from the grave. They do not believe in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. They believe that 144,000 people will be separate and you will be judged on your works. You'll be basically saved and elevated to another status based on what the good works you're doing. And 144,000 people will enter heaven and the other believers will stay on this earth. It's not what the Bible is teaching. And so I want to encourage Christ followers. You walk past these people and they're friendly and they're going to tell you, you don't believe the right gospel. Let us tell you the true gospel and the true Jesus. Do not be deceived. Because it's happening in the community in Langebaan right here. 150 meters away from this building. This is what Paul was saying, and it's happening today as well. If anyone proclaim another Jesus than the one we proclaimed, go and read what Paul is saying about Jesus. Or if you receive a different spirit from the one you received, or if you accept a different gospel. And the gospel we've just heard in chapter 5, Jesus is doing everything. He reconciled us. It's not his work and your good work. It's all his work. If anyone accepts a different gospel from the one you accepted, you put up with it readily enough. He says you receive a different gospel in the church. And how do we receive it? Well, we mostly receive it through the preaching, through what people are preaching, and through what you are listening to. Indeed, I consider that I'm not in the least inferior to these super apostles. Even if I am unskilled in speaking. Okay, because they are accusing Paul. Paul, you're not a good orator. Apparently, Charles Spurgeon would stand there and he would read all his sermons. He probably wasn't as passionate as I am. And just because I'm passionate and speak loud and jump up and down, doesn't mean now, whoa, that's the anointing. That just means God's word gets me excited and I want to preach this. And now you're following someone and they're shouting and they're screaming and they're jumping up and down and they've got everything on the external. They're extremely good communicators. I can try and convince you about a lot of things. Is it the word of God that we are preaching? And so see, Paul says, I'm unskilled in speaking. I'm not so in knowledge. Indeed, in every way we have this plain. We have made this plain to you in all things. And then verse 12 to 15, hear this. hang on, hear this. Chapter 11. And what am I doing? I will continue to do in order to undermine the claim of those who would like to claim that in their boasted mission, they work on the same terms as we do. It says these guys, they are claiming, they are preaching what we are preaching. They are claiming, they are saying what I'm saying, says Paul. But they're actually saying they are better than me. They're better than me. Paul is not the real deal. Get rid of Paul. Verse 13, for such men are false apostles, deceitful workmen, disguising themselves as apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for even Satan disguises himself as an angel of the light. So it is of no surprise if his servants, Satan's servants, also disguise themselves as servants of righteousness. Their end will respond to their deeds. What is Paul saying to his audience in our text this morning? He is saying, brothers and sisters, he's saying to the Corinthian church, there are these false apostles, teachers, preachers inside the church that is leading the church astray. They're preaching a false gospel, and you know what? Satan is behind it. This is dangerous. This is quite a serious word when he is speaking. This should bring you and me to a place of trembling before God. Not to handle the word of God lightly, but rightly. For you to grow in your understanding of assessing when people are preaching what they are preaching. Not how they are preaching, but what they are preaching. This is dangerous. So this is what Paul is saying here in 2 Corinthians 6. Do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. There are these guys that are preaching another Jesus, and Satan is behind it. So Paul is saying to his audience from this text this morning, if you don't leave these false teachers, God's presence will not be with you. And you will not grow in holiness. And so from this text this morning, I want to persuade you from God's text that we need to align ourselves with the gospel. Align yourself with the truth of the gospel and you will grow in holiness. So let's take a deeper look at this text. Verse 14a, I want to still stand still with this one. The first part of verse 14, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. This is a command from Paul and this is a command for us. Who are the unbelievers? Those in the church who oppose the truth. Okay? They oppose the truth. So don't hear what Paul is not saying. Paul is not saying, he's not telling them that unbelievers are not welcome in this gathering this morning. So if you're here this morning and you are not yet a believer in Jesus Christ, you're still trying to figure out who Jesus is, you are so welcome here. Paul is not saying you are not welcome here. We need to understand the word unbelievers. And to understand the word unbeliever, we have just read a little bit of context around it. So Paul is not saying unbelievers. So even let me convince this argument out of Paul's first letter. In 1 Corinthians 14, in Corinthians, the first letter, it says, you guys are very spiritual. You got a lot of spiritual gifts, but you're immature. Therefore, he puts chapter 13 between chapter 12 and 14 that deals with spiritual gifts. He says, you have no problem with spiritual gifts. Your meetings are wild, but you're immature. Everybody wants to be better than someone else. Everybody wants the mic. Everybody wants to impress with a prophetic word or a tongue or something else. It says, but you are immature. You're lacking love. And so chapter 13 is not an encouragement to love. It's in fact a rebuke to that church. And so now he says in chapter 14, he says, when unbelievers come in your midst. So telling us that we should expect non-Christians, non-Christian followers to be in our gathering on a Sunday. And he says, and when they come in and everybody speaks in tongues, and then this person's going to look around and there's no interpretation, and he's going to say, you guys are cuckoos. You're out of your mind. I'm out of here. But if someone brings an interpretation or there's a prophetic word or someone brings a word of knowledge for someone else, then truly that unbeliever will say, God is in your midst. He is there. God is in our midst, not because we feel goosebumps, not because we run around with emotionalism. And I'm not saying don't be emotional, because I am emotional. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that the level of the coming together is not measured on our emotionalism. But he says, guys, you're immature, so unbelievers should be there. 1 Corinthians 10, he says, when an unbeliever invites you to his house, go there. And for the sake of your conscience, don't eat the meat when they give you meat. If they give you salad, eat the salad. Befriend unbelievers. So unbelievers here cannot mean those who do not follow Jesus Christ yet. It means those false apostles in the church, those leaders in the church that is preaching another Jesus and another gospel. How many unbelieving friends do you have? A lot. Brilliant. I hope you can encourage us with that. I hope you can challenge us. I hope you can exhort and provoke us with that. Do you join the gym to get big muscles? Or do you join the gym or the bowling club or the running club or the whatever or the cake baking club or the needleworking club? Because there you're going to meet unbelievers who do not yet know Jesus, and you have an opportunity to preach the gospel through your actions and your words. As Christians, we should be the best friends. We should be the best friends. We should not befriend unbelievers as our little gospel projects. Oh, I led someone to Jesus. And counting. How many people have you led to Christ? Oh, 100. Oh, I did 101, brother. Last week, Sunday, we just baptized 1,000 people. Aren't we good as a church? Look at us. No. Don't hear what I'm not saying. I'm just saying it's very subtle if we draw attention onto ourselves. I want to befriend you because you are a human being and you are important. And if I do have the good news of Jesus Christ and I truly befriend you, man, I want to share with you the best news. I want to share with you the news that's going to impact eternity. I want to really care about you. You see, we have made evangelism to an event. It's a very narrow-minded thing. We go into the street and then the doors, we knock on the doors and ask people, or we stand in the lift and, I wonder if the lift goes down, if we die now, will you go to heaven? And we're sitting in an aircraft and we're doing that. Oh, have you ever thought about what's going to happen in the aircraft crash? Aircraft is most probably the easiest place, especially if there's turbulence, to start sharing Jesus. All of a sudden, everybody starts to pray. Don't hear what I'm not saying. I'm not saying don't share Jesus in those moments. Friends, I'm saying that's been narrow-minded. Been really broad-minded. When we truly befriend people, we have a long-term relationship with people so that there can be discipleship. We can really invest into other people's lives. I'm just calling you to both. I'm saying do both. Don't just do the one thing. Oh, I'm not really the evangelistic type. I don't knock on doors. Well, I don't enjoy that either. But I truly want to befriend un-Christians. I truly want to befriend non-Christians and be a good friend. Jesus was friends, but he never held back from speaking the truth in love. And so, yeah, no, we are not to disassociate ourselves with people. We are to disassociate ourselves with people who's not preaching the true gospel. Those who say reconciliation is not all of God. Chapter 5, verse 18. Those who say, oh, the substitutionary death on Jesus in our place for our sins, it's not enough. You need to add to that. Oh, it's good people that go to heaven. Oh, you need to work for your salvation. You need to impress God by external religiosity. No, those things are not true. So the reason why unbelievers are here to be understood that the leaders and the teachers in the church is even broader than that. When Paul speaks about these leaders in chapter 2, verse 17, he speaks about them. Chapter 5, verse 12, he speaks about them. In 5, verse 12, he says the following, we are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you cause to boast about us so that you may be able to answer those who boast about outward appearances. and not about what's in the heart. Paul is, his whole argument leading up to 2 Corinthians 6 verse 14 is making the case here that these unbelievers are the leaders in the church that's preaching a false gospel, a different gospel. They're preaching religion, Jesus plus something, and they're pulling themselves away even into temple worship of idols. And now Paul, to make sure that they understand that, then Paul follows into five questions. He's not looking for an answer to these questions. He's making his statement. When he says, don't be yoked with unbelievers, then he asks five questions to underline what he's asking or what he's commanding them to do. So the first question, he says, what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? And you're going to see now through all those five questions, indirectly, he's pointing them to five things about the gospel. Let's just call them five gospel wonders. So the first question is, what do righteousness and wickedness have in common? What's the gospel wonder? The gospel wonder is 2 Corinthians 5:21, that we have in Jesus, we've become the righteousness of God. We're new creation. In Jesus, I have his righteousness. 2 Corinthians 6, verse 7 says, by truthful speech and the power of God with weapons of righteousness in the right and the left hand. So he's saying we're living righteous lives. We're living right lives before God. God declared me righteous. Now I live. Left and right hand, what does it mean? Left hand, I had my shield, I protect. Right hand, I attack. So it means all of life. Right? Weapons of righteousness in left and right hand means we're living righteous lives. You've been declared righteous in Jesus. You've been accepted by Him. You're declared holy in Jesus. Therefore, live it out. Therefore, live it out. That's what He is speaking. So how can you have righteousness and wickedness? What can they have in common? No. Second question, what fellowship can light have with darkness? You are the light of the world. Jesus is the light of the world. Now you're a city set on a hill. Chapter 5, we read about the clay pots and the power of God's light shining into our hearts. The truth is in our hearts. And let us now shine out the light of the gospel. You have that. The third question, what harmony is there between Christ and Belial? Okay? And that's just the Hebrew root. The Hebrew root for this word Belial is describing the character of Satan, meaning worthlessness and evil. You won't find this word anywhere else in the Bible, but outside of biblical context, in ancient scripture, you would find reference to Satan based on his character traits, what he is doing. He's busy with worthless work. If you're going to follow religion, if you're going to think you're going to work for your salvation, you need to do good things, then you've been deceived by the devil. And it's a fruitful exercise that you're busy with. Fruitless, because no one can save you, only Jesus. You cannot save someone. You cannot go out and say, are we going to save souls? No, you proclaim the gospel. Jesus is doing the saving. He's doing the saving and the transformation. His work is evil. We've just seen in chapter 11, it says people are preaching a different gospel and Satan is behind it. There's deception. It is evil. So you are in Jesus. How can there be a togetherness? In chapter 5, 17, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. It says you have the promised Messiah who's now in you and you are in him. You are children of Jesus. He bought you with his blood. You are possessed by Jesus. He owns you. He indwells you. Question 4. What does a believer have in common with an unbeliever? I says, you're a believer, and he's actually taking them back through that question right to Old Testament history. Now, I was born, my surname Prinsloo, my adopted surname is Reynolds, and I can investigate both sets of family history. And it can be very exciting and nice and so, and it's very informative. So what? But now, in Jesus, I have a family history. Oh boy, that goes right back to Father Abraham. It goes back, he says, I want you to look back. I want you to go and look at Abel and Enoch and Noah and Abram and Isaac and Jacob and David and Samuel and all the prophets. You've got a different family line. You've got a different family history. No longer is it the color of my skin or the language that I speak. Idols. Some people boast in Jesus plus their culture. Some people boast in Jesus plus their language. Some people boast in Jesus plus their family history. Only Jesus. Once you're a new creation, you've got a new family line. I'm not saying disregard your other family. I'm saying it's there, celebrate it, but you can't add it to the cross. The fact that I'm a white male doesn't do anything to my salvation. The fact that I speak Afrikaans gives me no privileged place with Jesus in South Africa. In my culture that I grew up, and there's nothing, don't hear what I'm not saying. There's nothing wrong with speaking Afrikaans. Because that's the way that God created us. And I can be proud in it, but I can take it to a level above the gospel. And I can think that I'm part of a special elite race that God has called out. God's special people. No. In Jesus and before the cross, we're on level ground. Whether you speak Afrikaans or English or Shona, whether the color of your skin, which is, by the way, only skin deep, we bleed the same. We're exactly the same. Regardless of anything else, the one thing that defines us is Jesus Christ. And being in Him and being a new creation in Him, things have changed. And then He comes with a fifth question, and now He's taking up. He says, this is the question. Okay, I've asked you this question. Let me ask you this question, which culminates in this question. What agreement is there between the temple of idols and the temple of God? Meaning you and I. He's not asking, what is this building, this church building, have anything in common with a mosque? No, he's asking, what are these people inside the building have anything in common with people of the Islam faith? In November, they celebrate World Interfaith. And mostly, people will be on the stage. You will be an imam, Islam faith, and here will be a Hindu, and there will be a Christian, and there will be a Jew, and there will be an atheist, and there will be whatever and whatever and whatever. And we all, apparently the Pope said in the last couple of weeks, all faiths lead to the same God. You know, we go up the mountain, it just depends, you can take this road or that road, it leads to the same God. I'm not saying we don't honor and respect everyone. I'm saying that's a false gospel. Millions of people are led astray by a false gospel. All roads does not lead to Jesus. All roads does not lead to God, the Creator. Only through Jesus Christ. He's the only mediator, the God-man Jesus Christ. Completely God and completely man. What agreement is there between the temple of God and idols? The gospel wonder is that we are the temple of God. 1 Corinthians 3 and 1 Corinthians 6. You are the temple of God. You were bought with a price. You don't belong to yourself. You now belong to God who dwells in us by His Holy Spirit. Therefore, we don't have to have two quick songs and then three slow songs and press into the presence of God and do Christian magic to wait for God to appear. He lives in me. If I'm a new creation, if I follow Jesus Christ, the Word says I cannot say Jesus is Lord other than the Holy Spirit in me, and He lives in me, and I bring the presence of God in this place and wherever you go. Yes, there is the manifest presence of God where we bring gifts and spiritual gifts to build one another up, to edify one another. We expect God when we come together that the gifts would be present. But it would happen in an orderly manner. It will happen according to God's word. It will be so that we will be strengthened in our faith and built up. And so here are these five gospel wonders of the new covenant. Righteous in Jesus, my righteousness, my right standing, light in Christ. I'm a believer, I'm the temple. That is what he's saying to them. He's drawing them to their identity in Jesus. He's saying, this is who you are. And then the second part that we find here in verse 16 is giving them two promises. And these two promises are coming from the Old Testament. And just if they are unclear about their identity in Jesus, he then says in the latter part of verse 16, I will make my dwelling among them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. He's reminding them of two Old Testament promises. The first promise is a promise of personal intimacy. I will be their God. I will dwell amongst them. And we experience the presence of God and intimacy with Jesus. It's more than going to church. It's more than praying before you eat. But it's intimacy through the Holy Spirit with one another, through reading the Bible, studying the Bible. But we are yet to experience the fullness of God's presence. And when will that happen? When Jesus returns. We waiting the second coming of Jesus to renew this earth, to make a new earth. The Bible speaks about this place is going to be a garden city. And there will be no sun because the light of Jesus will shine. And we will live with him. And we will work. We will not be disembodied spirits dressed in white with violence and floating around on clouds. It's unbiblical. It's a lie. It's not what the Bible is teaching. There is a new earth and a new heaven. And we will dwell and we will be with God. And in a moment, in an instant of the second coming of Jesus, we will be changed and transformed into his likeness, glorified resurrection bodies. We cannot fully comprehend how this will be. The one thing that I misunderstood for many years out of Revelation was when I said, and then right at the end it says, and the sea was no more. So John had this picture of, and the sea was no more. So I encourage all my fishing buddies, guys, we better fish. Because when Jesus comes back, there won't be any more sea and we're not going to fish. By God's grace, I made progress in my understanding of Revelation and understanding that sea in Revelation is a picture of chaos and destruction and evil. And when he says, and the sea was no longer there, he didn't mean physically the sea was not there, but it's a new heaven and a new earth, and sin will dwell no more on this earth because the whole of the new earth will not be 16,000 cubits by this, by that, which is this resemblance of the temple, not physically, but symbolically the temple, meaning God will be amongst us. That's what Jesus said. I will dwell amongst them. So he's saying to them, I will be among them and walk among them. I will be their God. We're experiencing it now, but when Jesus returns and make a new earth and a new heaven, we will experience it in the fullness. Because then all of the new earth, this garden city, will be the Holy of Holies. And God will be with us. And we will work, and we will enjoy relationship, and everything will be perfect. We cannot completely understand and comprehend how this will be. But boy, that is what we're living for. I'm not living for making every day a Friday. I'm living for that day. And if God so happens to bless me with making a Monday a Friday, then so be it. Then thank you, Jesus. Thank you for it. Thank you for that. And I'm going to taste some good stuff, and I'm going to taste some awful stuff, because there's still sin in this world. And you and me, we're not exempted from it. And God is judging. But he's not judging unto condemnation those who are in Christ Jesus. But God is working. And we set our hearts on pilgrimage. Psalm, help me, 84. Set our hearts on pilgrimage. So there's a promise of personal intimacy, but there's also a promise of adoption. Verse 17 and 18, he says, therefore go out from their midst. Not don't have unchristian friends, don't allow non-Christians to come into you. Go out from these idol worshippers, these false gods. Stop following Jesus and idols. Stop following Jesus and your ancestors. I don't understand that culture. But maybe my brothers and sisters from Zimbabwe or other parts in South Africa, you might understand what it means. I follow Jesus. He's my Lord and Savior. But when things really get tough, I need to call on the ancestors. Syncretism. That's what, amongst other things, what Paul is talking here. Every culture got something. In my culture, there's the idol called pride. Self-righteousness is strong in my culture. But everything in our culture that's out of line with the gospel, we need to bring in the line of the gospel. We're not accusing one another. We're just saying, let's investigate our own lives, our own culture. What's neutral, be neutral. And what's out of line with the gospel, let's take that out. Those are idols. So what is Holy Spirit saying to you right now? What are the idols in your life? Because a good thing can become an idol. A good thing can become a God thing with a small g, which is a bad thing. Are you so worried to impress people by your appearance that you're 7 days a week in the gym? Because you're standing in the mirror and it's like, you're seeing, sorry if it's you, but I'm just going, they're looking in the gym and they're standing and checking and that's, yeah, I also love to do it. I also do that and say, oh my goodness, where's my muscles that used to, the little bit that was there is gone, it's missing. Where it is now and it's all changed. Then, okay, maybe I shouldn't take off my shirt when I go to the beach because they'll just say, look at that oomy, you know, it's all white, no muscles. And then I thought, maybe I should go to the gym and practice, which is nothing wrong, but what's the motive of our hearts? We try to impress. And so a good thing, exercise, can become a God thing. What is it for you? I don't know what it is for you. Pray and ask Holy Spirit to show you. And now Paul then drives home the fact that we should live holy lives, that we should separate ourselves from false teachers, especially in the church, especially leaders, especially people who preach and teach and lead people astray. That's a hard word for those who are preaching. If we are leading people astray, that is a very hard word. But also, what are the personal idols in our lives? And he drives this home in chapter 7, verse 1. Since we have these promises, which promises? The promise of God's presence and the promise of the fact that we are adopters. Let us cleanse ourselves from every defilement of body and spirit. And when he says body and spirit, he's speaking about the completeness here. Verse 1, 7 verse 1, is the completeness. Okay, it's personal and it's complete. Body and spirit, personal, complete. Separate yourselves from these things. Everything that impacts the believer's life. Everything. Bringing holiness to completion. You see, our holiness is not perfected yet. My identity in Christ is, I'm perfect in Jesus. That's my justification. That's my right standing. But my holiness is growing to become more like Jesus. And he says, let's bring this to perfection. There's a role that you and I have to play, and Holy Spirit works with us. So in summary, Paul says, possibly the greatest danger is in the church and not out of the church. Then he says, separate yourselves. Then he gives these five rhetorical questions to make his point clear. He reminds them of two Old Testament promises. He says, these two Old Testament promises have now been fulfilled in Jesus. And you have them in Jesus. The promise of intimacy with him and the promise of adopted as his children. Don't be yoked with unbelievers. Be yoked with the truth of the gospel because that's essential for our spiritual growth. Align yourself with the truth of the gospel and you will grow in holiness. Can I ask you to close your eyes? And I want to pray for us, 2 Corinthians 5, verse 14 and 15. 2 Corinthians 5. For the love of Christ controls us. So my question is, who controls you? Who controls me? Because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, and therefore all have died. And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves. Who are you living for? That those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. For our sake, for our eternal sake, for our identity and for our holiness, Jesus died and rose bodily from the grave. For our justification and our sanctification, he died and rose again. For who are you living? Who controls your life? Is it Jesus plus? Or is it just Jesus? Holy Spirit, I pray, show each one of us the idols that there might be in our hearts. We might be victims of the devil's deceit. But Holy Spirit, shine the light of Christ in our hearts and expose our idols. So as we symbolically come to the altar, we know that we've got nothing to bring and nothing to offer because Jesus did the heavy lifting. He paid the price. He lived a perfect, obedient, sinless life in my place. And then he took upon himself the righteous judgment of a holy God against sin. He absorbed all my sin, all the righteous judgment of God. He took upon himself, yet he was sinless. He was without sin. But God treated him as if he was the worst sinner. And he died for my sin, past, present, and future. So symbolically, I come to the person and the finished work of Jesus Christ. And there I stand with great boldness through the person and the finished work of Jesus. I come to the throne of grace and I say, Heavenly Father, where are my idols? What do I try to add to my right standing with you?